So, welcome to my talk. Welcome in this room for best practices from agile development. Why is positive thinking so important for software development? This is not a psychological talk. So this is not about your personal mood, you behave with your colleagues or in your environment. It's your personal attitude towards code. So what's this about? So why do I think this is important? Right now I have more than 20 years of experience in software development, and I'm focusing every time the same issues. I'm not talking about deployment or requirements, just how to approach to code, how to approach to an API. So it's all about software engineering. Who thinks in this room, who thinks, right, raise your hands please, who thinks he is making software engineering? The question is, what am I answering here? Should the answer not be 42? What is software engineering? What is programming? What is developing? I think there's a huge difference between software engineering, software programming, software developing. Many people do not differ those items. I differ them a lot. So, but just some words about myself, if it works. Yeah. Who am I? I'm interested in software development since the early 90s. Ooh. Okay, he's looking a little bit older. I'm doing software creation since 1999, so 20 years now. I was doing all the steps until now. From a programmer, I've been a consultant, an architect, senior developer, engineer, now I'm a manager, IT manager. So what does it mean? The topic is always the same, but the way you approach software is different. As a developer, depending on the stage and on the attitude of a developer, you know what to do because you are told to do that. Sometimes, and this is what makes the difference for me between a programmer and a developer, a programmer says, what should I do? And I do it, okay, in a perfect way. But a developer asks, is this what I have to do, the right way to do it, or is it not? Would there be a better solution? And an engineer is much more. An engineer has a look at the complete environment he is working in. He is taking into account the whole environment of the domain he is working in. He's not just working, he's creating something, or he tries to create something. So why am I thinking about that? As a manager, do I have time to think about such topics? Do I not have something better to do than just doing this psychedelic thing? Not only that, I'm cycling several thousand kilometers a year, and those who cycle know that the mind can be blown free, and you have a lot of time to think about things that are going wrong. And sometimes there are good ideas at the end. Okay, sometimes not. It depends on the judgment of the teams. But more or less, some good things will come up. So I'm presenting here my own opinion. It's sometimes a little bit dogmatic. But the main point is we can do whatever we want with code, with creating software. But we should know what we do and why we do it. So if we are, there's always a bunch of trade-offs. Yeah, database connections are expensive. Remote calls are expensive. We cannot do the software in a way we learned it to do, because this is an ideal world. And we are not dealing with ideal worlds, we are dealing with issues. Homemade issues, issues made by the context, by personalities, whatever. We have to take a lot of things into account to get the best solution. So I made a lot of programming languages in my past. luckily, Scheme and Prolog are not longer valid for me because that's my personal opinion. I like object-oriented or the newer functional programming language much better. And I was in the time of waterfall development. It's a little bit funny because this is another dogmatic approach. What is waterfall? What is agile? So are we doing agile? Yes, we all do agile. Are we agile? Do we think agile? Yes, we think agile. What is agile? Agile is all and nothing. The project failed. Why did it fail? Because we made it agile. No, we did it in the wrong way. So it's all about, do I know what I do? And what is positive thinking in that way? Positive thinking is not only smile to the team, yeah, or be happy with the result, even it failed. Because, okay, this psychological feeling, every fail is a reason to improve the skills. So it's something good. Okay, other meanings are different. I think, and this is something what I discovered through the years, 15 years ago until now, and that's a little bit horrible, I think. This is until, what is that? Okay, seems to be an exception. When I look into the log files of an application that starts up, so the Tomcat server starts, or the JBoss or whatever server in the application runs, there are a lot of exceptions. And I'm asking some guys or ladies, what kind of exception? Oh, that's normal. Why is an exception normal? Why? What the hell? An exception, so I'll come later to the topic of exceptions because I cannot cover the whole thing I would like to cover because this talk is not long enough for that. We could spend several days with that topic. But I'll try to pick up some details and give you some hints in a very agile world, how to approach software development and how to get things onto the road, how to get things deployed, not in a technical way, but in a mental way. Sometimes we are thinking too much about details. Sometimes we are thinking too much about the wrong requirements. So that's another thing. Can a programmer in my world discover what are good requirements, what are bad requirements? A developer maybe, a software engineer should take care if the requirement is good or bad. Any exceptional behavior is not positive thinking. Of course, there are exceptions. But some people think in exceptions. And if there are too many exceptions, what is the rule then? To have the exception or to have the business workflow? And I'm not telling about doing the business workflow by exceptions. The business workflow should follow the business rules and not exceptions that are thrown. The result to ignore it might be painful. This happened this year on Mallorca to me. Okay, a little bit broken the head, but keep the thumbs up. Everything is good. The question is, how can we avoid this? Just by positive thinking? No. I have to do the context a little bit, or I have to open the context a little bit larger. We have to talk about software engineering. Ask three architects, I guess architects are very experienced software experts. Ask the three architects, what is software engineering? And you get five answers. Everyone defines this topic on its own. My approach is software engineering writing code. Don't care about this code, if it's good code or bad code. Is writing code software engineering? Or is creating architecture some kind of software engineering? Or what about using design principles, design patterns? So my answer is, software engineering is all and more, a lot more. It's your personal intention, it's your personal attitude, it's your experience. And this is an important fact, in my opinion. I have found a very good definition of software engineering by the IEEE Systems Vocabulary. It says, software engineering is the systematic application of scientific and technological knowledge, methods, and experience to the design, implementation, testing, and documentation of software. I could not have said this better. But there is a secret in this sentence, in my opinion. A secret that's not visible at the first sight. What is the secret? So there are administrational things, there are operational things, there are things coming from external, and there are things coming from internal. Huh? What does this mean? Scientific, technological knowledge, methods. This is something you are taught. You go to university, you go to school, wherever a teacher, a professor tells you, this is the technology, or you go to a conference and see new technical features by new frameworks. Okay, this is the technology, this is the method you use it, so you are taught to do this. Is this your experience? No. You believe what the others say, because they look professional. Or they even say they are professional. They might be, okay. Implementation, testing, and documentation. Ah, documentation. Who would state that the own documentation? I did not do anything. This is an IT expression. I didn't do anything. I didn't touch anything. Who would say that the documentation is very good of the own artifacts? Yeah, you're lying. The other thing is, this is something you have to do. It's, I don't really call it monkey work, because you need a lot of experience to do the right testing. You need experience to do the right documentation, because don't write tons of paragraphs, just write the correct things down. But the most important thing is experience. Experience is not something that you can get by money, or that you can get by dream, or whatever, or that someone can tell you. Experience is something that you have to gain. And this is a very important part of software engineering. What makes a good software engineer? His experience. Because he knows what this solution can have for side effects, or could have an impact in this context. So the same solution in a different context can be a completely, could have a completely different impact. It could be a very bad solution. So experience is something that you gain through years by doing software development. And I think I gained quite a lot of experience, so that's my personal opinion, others may judge differently, but this is something you have to do on your own. No one can bring you that. So, and this experience must be covered by your daily work in agile development. Why am I focusing this on agile development? Because waterfall is quite, I call it simple. It can be extremely complex, but the process is quite simple. You have your different steps. Each step follows the other one. So you have your quality gates to reach the next step. Everything is okay. But agile development means we have to deliver very fast, high quality, security reviewed. The customer is waiting for it. the client demands a very quick deployment. So, and you know, the client changes his mind every week. So if you started your work, at the end of the day, the client might have changed his requirements and you should react on that. You should take this into account that this influences the way you are doing the software development. So you cannot rely on the requirements that are given at the beginning of this project, of this sprint, whatever. So of course, if you're working with Scrum, at the beginning of the sprint, the requirements for this sprint should not change. If they change, the stories are taken out of the sprint log, and then you'll do something different. But the time changes. So we, in our company, we are having more than 2.5 billion logins per day. Imagine this number, 2.5 billion logins. We have such an amount of use cases, and the login is just this one. So you can imagine how much use case triggered events we have on our systems per day. So the software development must take this into account and must, we cannot have a downtime. We have to react very quickly. We have to do the software development in a way that that is different from standard ways, because the cycle time of the story has to be quite short. And how do I get this? How do I manage to deliver fast and quickly, and I follow the rules for quality gates, for reviews, and all this stuff? The answer is do the right things for at the right time. And this positive thinking is something that influences the software development lifecycle. What does this mean, the software development lifecycle? Let's have a look at an example. We do sometimes business process modeling. Yeah. We know it. So there's an entry state, and there are some indicators, and some actors, and some process steps. And when we have a look at this diagram, it's not important what the different icons mean or what the swim lanes try to explain. This is just the way when a customer buys a product and he doesn't have enough money, he wants to have a credit. So this is the process how the credit department of a sales company works. Maybe it's a little bit more complex, it's a little bit abstract level, but when we and now follow try to follow the ideas, when you try to model something, what do? You try to cover everything, because the model is the base for the development team. The development team has to have a look into the model and say, oh, what do we have to do? Who is calling whom? Which is the payload? Is it a remote call? Is it a local call? Whatever. So it's a kind of a documentation. At this point, we have to ask, what is the business model of a credit department of a credit bank? What is the business model? The business model is success. What means success? Success means the credit will be approved and not refused. Because the business model of a credit bank is not refusing credits, it's approving credits. So this is the first mind shift. When the business model is approving credits and not refusing credits, why do we model refusing credits in the first stage of this model? I've seen this hundreds of times. I said, skip this, because this is not the business model. The client wants to see if his process works. So you know, maybe most of you know the prototyping approach. You do a first prototype of a software. Would you prototype or would you include the refuse of a credit into the prototype, into the first prototype? No one would do that. Why? We earn money by approving credits, not by refusing. Of course, someday we have to take care of refusing credits as well, because if the financial standing of the applicant is not very good, then we should, of course, refuse this credit. But it's not at the first step of development or at the first steps. Yeah? So this is the positive way of the business model without any, I call it anti-business pattern. Because refusing something which is not my business increases my complexity at this time without having the need to see this or without having the need to do this right now. So what we do, or what I recommend is always, this is my hint number one, split the functional scope into happy path milestones. If you call it step one, step two, or milestone one, don't care. Split it into parts. And the first parts are just happy paths, nothing more, only happy paths. So when I say it, you can keep this in mind for later, no errors, absolutely no errors. So if you take this, the range is not that good. Someday you'll come to the final release of your artifact. And the final release is something that goes live. Of course, this final release has to cover everything, even refusing a credit, even error handling. But you have, and that's experience of software engineering. Which is the right step to include the first misbehavior issues of the software. The hint number two, I'll come soon to it. If you put your project into milestones, your feature development into milestones, what is covered by the milestones? The milestones cover requirements. Maybe not all requirements are covered by milestone one because it's agile development. This requirement is clear. I can start with that. That's my milestone one. The other requirement is not clear yet. So we have to investigate. We have to discuss. We have to wait for the final requirements. So this is hint number two. Make explicitly use of the author review cycle. So for those who seem to be a little older, maybe similar experience than me for 20 years. The author review cycle was a hype in the 90s. Why do we skip this today? This is a good thing. I can also give at least the answer of a consultant. What's the answer of a consultant? It depends. And it depends is also the correct answer, because you need your experience to discover if this is the right time for a review with the client or with the customer. The author review cycle says, whenever you implemented a part of the requirement, show it to the customer and let him approve your solution, because the requirements might change. You know all this this project picture with the tree and the different views of projects. Yeah, what the customer requests, and at the end, what the customer really needed. There's sometimes a huge gap. And the author review cycle is able to reduce the gap, to make the changes small, less complex. That's positive thinking. think with the perspective from the perspective of the customer and detect what he really needs and satisfy him. Because the customer himself is only interested in the happy path. The customer is not interested in bad requests, database errors. The customer doesn't care. He says, that's your domain. I trust you. I have found a nice statistics at Coding Sense, which says the second largest cause of delivery problems is the lack of clearly defined deliverables. This is quite interesting. And this is from 2019, so it's very popular, it's from nowadays. And still, the lack of clearly defined deliverables was one of the most reasons were for problems since 20 years. What changed in the last 20 years? In this context, nearly nothing. Why? Because people are taught to do things because, and that's the normal sentence in a company, we are used to do it this way. Okay, but do we know what we do? Maybe. What about this error handling now? Where do I put the error handling into the milestones? The answer is, it depends. It depends on the requirements, it depends on the size of the project, it depends on on the processes you are following. And my recommendation is, start the first milestone without any error handling, without any bad paths, just the lucky way. I have to stay here a little bit. The next one is when some kind of middleware is ready, the backend database will be covered by this milestone, and then, hopefully, the front-end development will be started. And here you can see those milestone releases of the middleware and the backends will cover the first error codes, not earlier. And at the end, we have a complete final release with the complete error handling. So as I said, at the end, this release should cover all possible errors. So we need a lot of positive tests that increase the probability that our software is really working correctly. We need a lot of negative tests to increase the probability that our software is really working robustly. So this is also something gained from experience, from a long time experience. So the software development life cycle in this way is much shorter because due to the author reviewer cycle, requirement changes can be done much earlier. We can present the first prototype of this artifact much faster because we don't care about errors. You know, when you are waiting for the deliverable of another team who is providing a service API, what do you do? Are you complaining the whole day or are you just mocking it? Just mock it. Just mock the remote API. That's positive thinking. I do it on my own. I don't rely on them. And the question is, where do exceptions fit in? Exceptions, another big topic. 15 years ago, I was talking about exceptions. Nowadays, the talks are the same. Because people do not really care about exceptions. Exceptions are expensive, period. Still. We have very powerful machines, the JVM is better, but exceptions are bad, period. The first exception ever known, caused by a bug, is a nice comic. I've read the Oracle documentation for an exception, and there's an important sentence. An exception is an event which occurs during the execution of a program that disrupts the normal flow of the program's instructions. Clearly said. I think it's the same description than the Sun documentation said about exceptions. But what is important in this sentence? It disrupts the normal flow. The normal flow is the business indicated flow. Which steps do I want to cover in my program? And an exception is something that is an error. If the exception is the normal way, why do I use then the method of an exception or the technique of an exception? Skip it, please. Exception, whatever I do with it. Some other talks say, wrap the exception to another class, to another method, to a util class, whatever. But then I just put a frosting on top of this pile of shit. Nothing more. I can do it in different ways, but it's always the same shit. Now have a look at this little piece of code. Hopefully everyone can read it. It's a very simple API. Customer get customer with a by customer ID throws illegal argument exception customer not found exception. Have a look into your code. How many throws declarations do you find? 1,000 lines of code, maybe 100 lines of throws. Maybe. But much too much, I think. Why do we think in exceptions? Think positive. Why should an exception happen? Here's a good example for this positive thinking. What means customer not found exception? What does the API say here? The question is, what do we expect from an API? I'm designing API. So designing API needs a lot of experience to do it well. Otherwise, we have to change it several times during production time, and that's much more expensive than in the design phase. What do we expect from an API? Have a look at this. Get customer by ID and the exceptions. It said get customer. So if you get null, is that a satisfaction by this API? No. Null is not a customer. Null is everything. You get a customer not found exception. Why do I get an exception? I call get customer. Maybe some people remember design by contract. It was popular 20 years ago, but it's still very popular, but it's not in our daily thinking. What do I expect? If you go to a bakery and you want some fresh bread and it's completely sold out, what are you, happy or sad? You're sad. But this is something that you might expect because it's your daily living, it's your experience that some things might be sold out. But you have the expectation. You went there because you hoped to get bread. So you go to this API and say, please give me this customer. So what would be a good API design for that in the way of positive thinking? To avoid those exceptions. How do I design a good API without using exceptions? Now you see, just one exception was removed. This is a little bit more design by contract. It's not covered completely, this design by contract approach. Please don't complain, but it would not fit onto this screen here. So the question is, if has customer returns true, I can call get customer without any exception. And that's a different mindset. Why do you throw a customer not found exception? Oh, because it's easy. We all do that. Why are you all doing that? Just try to think different. Try to approach an API from a happy path. What is the trade-off here? Now, the more experienced people see, okay, here's a data source. The trade-off is the data source might be called several times. Might be expensive. Might be the solution that, okay, we use a cache. Okay. So this is something that can only be answered by a software engineer who has the right experience to discover what the advantages and disadvantages are and what the benefits are. And what is the risk and how much are the costs of this solution? The next thing is an approach. Already I found a quote in 1983 saying, exception handling considered harmful. It was published March 1983. Why did we forget this? Because we are used to do it. It's so easy. It's very easy to throw an exception. Huh? So 20 years ago, the boss, my former boss said to me, Andre, make it to your problem. That's exception handling. Make it to your problem. So it's your fault that you call me. But I don't want to answer this properly. Make it to your problem, the error handling. So I should try to avoid this. Avoid functional errors as long as possible, but keep technical exceptions. That's positive thinking. Functional errors, avoid functional errors. This customer not found exception can be avoided just by calling, if this customer exists, then get customer will answer 100%. But of course, this is just an ideal world, because if you know what the ideal world is able to offer to you, then you know the costs and the risks if you leave that ideal world. And that is software engineering. That makes a really good software engineer who is able to discover that. of course, it's not all about exceptions, because the range of indicators for good software or bad software, for good design, bad design, is very large. But if you approach this software development with a positive thinking, you will see that the cycle time decreases, that you are able to deliver faster, you are able to satisfy the customer earlier. Because the customer gets the first prototype earlier. Okay, now the trade-off. At least you have 4 milestones. Just an example, 4 milestones, and then the final release comes. The first 2 milestones, or the first 3 milestones, are the happy path requirements. The customer is satisfied and says, hey, come on, you're ready, everything is working now. No, we have to do the error handling. Why? It's working. So the trade-off is to convince the customer that you need the originally estimated time to fulfill all requirements regarding exceptions, error handling, and so on. the code is better maintainable because you have less exception handling. You have a better understanding of an API. Sometimes you need to read the documentation of what the API does and why particular exceptions are thrown. Why? Why do you? If you design your API, you name your variables in a good way, you name the API, and the context is clear, then it's often proved you do not need the documentation. You just need the documentation for details. But it's a lot of work to do that. It's more work than just doing simple stuff. Ah, come on, throw some exceptions and it's okay for in this context. So do real software engineering based on happy paths to satisfy the customer very early and to gather time for proper error handling. Because if you know that you fulfilled all the functional requirements, you can now focus completely on the error handling. Sometimes, from a technical perspective, you have to declare errors very early if another team awaits the API from your side. They are waiting with their final implementation. That's also some kind of experience in your context. When is the best way to introduce error handling? So think positive, but beware of errors is the slogan you should keep in mind. And I'd like to motivate you to think more about a good happy path design, to avoid exceptions and to think positive. Because when you try thinking positive, then you will see that the other team members who are forced to work with your piece of software are much happier. And that's my experience. It's worth doing it to try thinking positive. Thank you. If you have any questions, just come up to me. Or we have 7 minutes left if there are public questions. Yes?
I think that this example with test customer and guest customer is quite controversial. And the reason why I think so is that there is no way to guarantee that the user of the API will ever call the test customer.
So the message was, it's no guarantee that has customer was called before calling get customer. That's absolutely true. The first answer is, would a good software engineer do that? No. But that's the ideal world. We have to guarantee by software that it's working perfectly fine. So this design by contract, I was just scratching it. The design by contract approach says, each API has preconditions and postconditions. So the precondition of this get customer API is, if you call has customer and has customer returns true, then you are allowed to call me and I won't answer without any exception. But then you have two calls. The postcondition is you will never ever receive null or optional empty, which is a better approach than just return null. And it's always guaranteed that this object really exists. But you have to do it in a transactional context then. So that's, of course, the trade-off. Yeah, but keeping preconditions and postconditions is the way to solve that by software. And there are several frameworks following this design by contract approach who provide this precondition and postcondition annotations. Aber well seen, yes? Thank you. Enjoy your time, the last day on DevOps. Thank you. Thank you.